Welcome to Smart Catalyst, December 4, 2018. So today we are going to see all these prelims articles. The first one is Qatar to quit OPEC in Jan 2019. The second one is tariff truce on US-China trade war. The third one is services agree on permanent chair. And the fourth article is IMD on the warmer winter in store as El Nino brews over Pacific. And the last prelims article is COP24. The World Bank doubles the fund to the needy countries to tackle the climate change. So the first article is Qatar to quit OPEC in Jan 2019. So what the news here is, the Qatar is planning to leave the OPEC, which is the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, from next month in order to focus on the natural gas production. That is, they want to shift from the oil production to the gas production. So that is what the news here, okay? So why they actually decided to do so, in the sense, because the new energy minister of Qatar, he stated like, we don't have greater potential in oil and we want to be very realistic. So instead of focusing on something which is not your core business, we just want to focus on something which gives us more long-term benefit. So that is what the natural gas. So they are just planning to shift to the natural gas. Okay. So if you see in the past, that is in September this year, the Qatar actually announced a boost of its gas production to 110 million tons per year by 2024. So this is their target. So it actually implicitly mentioned that they just want to shift their energy focus from oil to gas, right? So one more thing you have to note here is Qatar is a member of OPEC since 1961, as it is 17th largest producer of the crude, but it only holds around 2% of the world's global oil reserve, but it is still a major producer, okay? So why this decision, in the sense, the turbulent time in the Gulf politics. So what they are mentioning here, in the sense, if you see, usually there was a previous diplomatic rift in the relationship between Qatar and the other Gulf countries like the Saudi Arabia, UAE and Bahrain. So these three countries joined together and it actually claiming that Qatar is supporting to armed forces or terrorism, okay? So Qatar is blamed by all these three countries, and also apart from this, it also alleged the support of the political Islamist movement such as Muslim Brotherhood and as well as Al Jazeera media network. So every blame is put over the Qatar by means of these three Gulf countries. So after all these blame games by the Saudi Arabia as well as UAE and Bahrain over Qatar, they are now actually blaming again Qatar for not abiding to the OPEC production targets. Okay, so this is also another blame over Qatar. So for all these things only, Qatar is now want to withdrew its membership from the OPEC. Okay, so now we are going to see what this OPEC means, Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. So it is a permanent intergovernmental organization of all these countries, but while it was creating, it is having like the founder members are Iran, Iraq, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia and Venezuela. So it was created at Bogdad conference in 1960. Okay, it headquarters is Vienna in Austria. As of now, it is having like 15 countries, which is having a worth of 44% of global oil production and 81% of global oil reserves. Okay, so these are some of the objective of the OPEC countries. Okay, so majorly it is like maintaining and determining the oil prices in the world economy. The next article is tariff truce on US-China trade war. So this article talks about the trade tariffs and the trade war as well as the tariff truce and who has more to lose. So this is what this article talks about. So on agreeing to 90-day tariff truce, so truce in the sense it is like a break, okay, or it is merely ceasefire kind of a thing, okay, so it is going to continue after that period of time. So that is what it meant. So after the 90-day agreement of tariff truce by US and China, the global trade war which is happening between them has come to a welcome pass. So what you have to know here is the US government will refrain from raising the tariff on the Chinese goods, which is worth of $200 billion, from the current rate of 10% to 25%. Okay, so they actually planned it, but they now refrained. They are not going to do it, only for a period of 90 days. So this is what the news here. Okay, so it actually indicates that the two countries, that is the two greater giant, one is the US and the China, they both want to rapproach themselves and as well as to ensure the smoother relationship of the bilateral trade. So this is what this 90-day agreement indicates, right? And one more thing is, in return for this US 90 days, China is also now promising to purchase agri as well as other goods from US. Why China is doing this means in order to reduce the trade imbalance which is existing between US and China. That means now US is exporting more from China, so now China is trying to equate it. Okay, so apart from these 90-day agreement, one more thing you have to note here is the Canada and the Mexico along with US, they have actually come to an agreement which is called a compromise trade agreement, which was replacing the previous NAFTA agreement, which is North American Free Trade Agreement. Okay, so these are all indicating that every country is trying to rapproach with US, thereby the global trade war has come to certain kind of pass. And these are the signs that indicate the global war that began in 2018 yearly, maybe cooling down a little bit in the 2018 end. So why they are doing this? That means why US and China is suddenly moving for this kind of 90-day agreement, in the sense the clear reason is not yet known, but maybe the significant slowdown in the Chinese economy after this trade war, as well as the concerns over the negative impact of the trade war on the American financial markets. So these two economies are now a little bit suffering. So because of these may have played a part in this kind of 90-day agreement. Okay, so this is what the author suggested here. But anyway, this kind of temporary truce of 90 days offers some kind of relief, because this trade battle which is happening between these two countries bring global economical growth to a grinding halt at some point of time in the future. So in order to prevent that, we need these kind of breaks. So this is what he suggested. Okay, so the next article is services agree on permanent chair. So this article talks about the appointment of a permanent chairman of the Chiefs of Staff Committee. So why they are wanting to bring this position, in the sense in order to bring more cooperation among the heads of the defense forces, that is the Army, the Navy, as well as the Air Force. We have three defense forces, right? So in order to bring the cooperation among the working of all these three organizations, we need a central authority who is this permanent chairman. Okay, so now all these people are accepting to appoint this permanent chairman of the Chief of Staff's Committee. So if you see the composition of the committee, it is having the Chief of Army, Navy and Air Force, and apart from this, one more person who is the Chief of Integrated Defense Staff. Okay, so he is not having voting right. And apart from these four members, if and all needed, then a scientific advisor is also invited to attend the meeting. Okay. So now we are going to see what is the role of such permanent chairman means. He is the authority for advising the defense minister, normally through the Cabinet of Political Affairs. So he is advising him through this committee on only military matters which require ministerial consideration. So he is like a single point military advisor to the government, and he is one operational commander to all the three defense forces. Okay, so the next article is IMD, which stated like warmer winter in store as El Nino brews over Pacific. So what this article state here is, the IMD recently issued a statement titled Seasonal Outlook for Temperatures. So in that, what they are actually mentioned is, as the El Nino brews over the Pacific, there is a possibility of warmer winter, thereby it affects the monsoon of India. Okay, so if it affects the monsoon, then we are having not enough rainfall, which leads to drought condition. So this is what stated by the IMD report. Okay, so now we are going to see what this El Nino means. So you have to know one thing here, that is El Nino is always associated with warming. Okay, so it is warming of the Pacific Ocean, especially near the Peru region. Okay, and La Nina is reverse, that means it is associated with the cooling of the Pacific Ocean, especially near the Peru coast. Okay, so here it is Peru, right? So if you see this El Nino phenomena, what actually happened here is, there is an abnormal increase in the temperature. Okay, so there is an abnormal increase in the temperature of the Pacific Ocean, and because of this abnormal increase in temperature, the air mass started rising, and this air mass is pushed towards the western direction by the trade winds. Okay, so the trade winds actually push the hotter air mass towards the western direction, but on the way itself, due to the cooling, it actually precipitated a lot and in this region. Okay, and only the remaining dry air is reaching the Indian Ocean region as well as the Australian continent region. Okay, so this subsidence of dry air mass created a high pressure on our side, that is the Indian Ocean and Australian side. Okay, so because of this, there is a drought condition. So this is what now predicted by the IMD report. Okay, so El Nino has different impacts in different parts of the world and at different times of the year, but usually during the northern hemisphere summer season, El Nino has been associated with drought in Indonesia, northern Australia, India and North Latin America. Okay, the next article is COP24. The World Bank doubled the funds to the needy countries to tackle climate change. So the UNFCCC's COP24 meeting was held at Katowice, which is in Poland, yesterday. Okay, so during this COP24 meeting, they actually plan to frame some policies which is in line with the Paris Agreement climate change action. So this Paris Agreement was framed during the COP21. So it is now in line with the COP21. They just want to expand the framework, so thereby we can achieve the climate change adaptation in a very better and efficient way. So apart from this, in this COP24 meeting, the World Bank also announced a fund of nearly $200 billion for the needy countries, especially for the developing countries, in order to tackle the climate change as well as to build resilience against the climate change. Okay, so this World Bank's fund is entirely different from the Green Climate Fund, because here it is the World Bank, but now here it is the developed countries which is giving the money to the developing countries, at least in the range of $100 billion every year from 2020. So these both funds are UNFCCC's fund only, and in that they also mentioned like at least 25% of the money which is given by the World Bank, it should be utilized for climate adaptation projects. So now we are going to see what is the source, that is where the World Bank is getting the money. In the sense, half of the money, nearly $100 billion, is provided by the World Bank directly, but the remaining $100 billion is provided by combination or jointly by IFC, MIGA, as well as some other private funders. Okay, but it didn't mention anything about whether the money is providing to the developing countries in the form of loans or grants. So it is not mentioning anything about that. So now we are going to see the main article. The first one is Two Punjabs, One South Asia. The second one is Make Planning Fashionable Again. And the third one is Beyond the Binaries. The fourth article is China Deserves Its Economic Success. And the fifth article is MPC Should Take Rate Hikes Off the Table. And the last main article is Johnson & Johnson case is a step in the right direction finally. So the first main article is Two Punjabs, One South Asia. So this article talks about the Kartarpur corridor, which is there to ease the travel of Sikh pilgrims to the resting place of Guru Nanak, which is a Gurudwar in Kartarpur. Okay, so by means of this, doing this as an initial step between India and Pakistan, it enables the travel of the Sikh pilgrims from here to here, right? So it is an initial step, but by means of doing this and by means of genuine federalism, if at all genuine federalism is bringing in these two countries, then not only the India-Pakistan rapprochement, but also the glory of the South Asian future can also be regained. So this is what this article mentioned about. Okay, so for achieving all these things, what we require is the sub-national engagement between the South Asian countries, and this is a starting point. This is what the author mentioned here. So by means of bringing in this Punjab-Punjab formula between the provinces of Pakistan and the states of India, we can easily enhance the peace, trade and the people-to-people contact between these two countries, as well as we can catalyze the cooperation in the larger South Asian region as a whole. So a realistic formula for South Asian regionalism lies only in allowing these two federal units, which is the India and the Pakistan, to run on its own autonomical way. Okay, we all know that India is a more stable democracy And Pakistan is still now struggling against extremism, military supremacy, as well as the state centralism. So in order to tackle all these things, we need to have a good kind of relationship between these two countries in all aspects. So if you see here, the Punjab province of Pakistan as well as the Indian Punjab, both are powerful. So not only in that perspective, you have to note here one more thing. We were sharing a lot of similar history. That is, the Indian Punjab as well as the Pakistan Punjab were sharing a similar history, because we were both the stepping stone for invaders. We are the battlegrounds that go back millennia, and the shared tragedy of partition as well as the shared culture and the language of the Punjabiyat. So these all are the similar or the common ground for both the Punjab people, but there is no one to remember or remind this reality of the shield border, which was set only in 1947 for most part of the subcontinent. Only after 1947 only we are having these borders and all between the countries. Before and all, we are all having similar thoughts, similar culture, sharing everything, right? But there is no one to remember or remind all these things. So that is what the author raised the concern over here. Okay. So this Kartarpur spirit can make the pilgrims venturing out on a journey which breaks the barriers of the history, which opens the borders of heart and mind, and a journey which together towards a future of shared peace and prosperity, especially between India and Pakistan. So by means of this Kartarpur corridor, which connects the India Punjab to Pakistan Punjab, we not only ensure the future of India-Pakistan relationship, but we can also promote the stability in South Asian region as a whole. How means? The author is suggesting like the South Asian regionalism should be understood as a project for social justice. We have to think this whole entity as a single entity. So instead of maintaining massive militaries, and instead of blocking each and every other country by tightening the national borders, and instead of following the ultra-nationalist attitude, we, all the countries, should understand the economic synergy which is present among all the countries from the history or from the past, and we should achieve the cooperation among all the South Asian countries through economic rationalization, sub-regional interaction, and reduced military budget. So this is what mentioned by him. And we should take Nepal and India relationship as a role model, because we are having open borders, right? We are having open borders and free trade, and we are having similar kind of culture, tradition, etc. So only we are having this much closer relationship. So similar to this, we should promote these kind of relationship with all other South Asian countries. This is what mentioned by the author in this article. So the next article is Beyond Binaries. So this article talks about the gender-based discrimination, especially towards the transgenders, and the problems faced by those people, and what we should do in order to ensure a dignified life to those people. So if you see here, the transgender people have a gender identity or expression which differs from their assigned sex at birth. Okay, so this is what makes them the transgender category, and they are sometimes referred to as transsexuals if they desire the medical assistance in order to change from one biological sex to another. And as per 2011 census, approximately nearly 5 lakh people are transgenders. So in India. So the Indian mythology as well as the ancient literature and all always treated the transgender community with high respect and dignity. But in the recent times, they are, the transgender community are discriminated and their dignity is degraded. So how we are going to tackle all these issues? So that is what we are going to see. So they were enjoying huge respect and dignity in the past, but from the 19th century, that is especially from the late 19th century, their position is started degrading, and they are subject to extreme forms of social ostracization as well as exclusion from basic dignity and human rights itself. So it is like violation of Article 14, 21, 19, right? So this all should be taken care of. And one more major concern here is the transgender community are highly vulnerable to the gender-based violence, as well as they are more vulnerable to the fatal communicable disease, which is the HIV. So if you see in United Nations AIDS report, the HIV prevalence among the transgenders is like 3.1%, which is the second highest among all the communities. So it is a major concern, right? So what the government had been doing all these days in order to ensure the dignity of those people means laws, policies, and their implementation, like providing quota to those people and giving special consideration to the transgender people. These all has been taken by the government, especially if you see in case of Tamil Nadu, they are providing ID cards to those people, And Odisha government is also doing a lot of things in order to ensure their life, dignity and all. So these are some of the examples which is happening in the state level things. And apart from this, the Supreme Court recognized them as the third gender, and the Transgender Persons Bill 2016 has also been passed in Rajya Sabha. So it is a major move, but it's now pending in Lok Sabha, okay? So the National AIDS Control Organization also providing leadership to HIV AIDS Control Program, which in turn trying to reduce the HIV AIDS, especially among the transgender people, okay? So these are some of the steps which were taken by the government, right? But not only this is enough, but a multi-pronged approach is actually needed. Thereby we can empower the transgender community as a whole. Thereby we can reduce the discrimination towards the community in particular. So how we can achieve means by means of mass awareness campaigns, generating avenues for their dignified employment in all sectors, as well as gender sensitization and affirmative action should be taken. So the next article is China deserves its economic success. So this article talks about the economic success of China and how it is different from the erstwhile Soviet Union and how China actually reached this position, that is the leading global player. Okay, so China has become world's second largest economy after US and a leading global player by means of having a successful policy of committed structural reform. So here a major question is, will China continue to rise in the same path or will it disintegrate us like the Soviet Union? So why this question? In the sense, we all know that the trade war is happening between US and China. But if you go deep into this, it is not rooted in any kind of military standoff or military war kind of thing. It is just like an ideological conflict between two great nations, okay? So if you consider that, then the prediction that China could replace US as the dominant global economy in the near future have no doubt that which fuel the American anger. And not only that, but in case of China, its economy is much more open than many other countries during the same period, and its trade success is especially contributed by the exports, because 60% of the GDP growth of China is purely dependent on the exports, okay? And one more thing you have to note here is there is no logic at all to compare the China's growth with the Soviet Union, because there is a serious flaw in comparison itself. The Soviet Union is not having dynamism, it is not having financial incentive for economic risk taking, there is no market competition, there is no free trade with the developed economies and decentralized governance system. But these all things are now taken by, or it is followed by China, right? So it is, China is exhibiting a severe dynamism. So it is majorly different from the Soviet Union. You should not compare it. This is what he stated here, okay? And China is also ensuring like the decentralization of the considerable economic authority to the local government. Okay, so this is a major move, right? So despite of all these positive things, there are certain concerns also. The growth model of China is now export driven. So instead of following the export driven growth model, if China is turning into a domestic consumption driven growth model, then the development of China could be sustainable and China will go will rise in the same path as expected. So this is what they mentioned here. Okay, so the next article is Monetary Policy Committee should take rate hikes off the table. So we all knew that RBI is the authority which is deciding the repo rate, reverse repo rate, bank rate, etc., right? So when they are actually increasing this repo rate means if there is any inflation in the economy. If there is no inflation, then there is no need to raise the repo rate, right? So repo rate or any rates by the RBI. So that is what now happening. That means there is no symptom of inflation in the economy as of now. So RBI's chances of increasing the repo rate or reverse repo rate in the near months or nearer months is very lesser. So that is what put forward here. That means if you see the global oil prices, it is now decreasing and our rupee is also depreciating. And the increase of the MSP by the government, whether it impacts the rate of the food products, it is also not clear. So this, the impact of this is also not clear. And the sanctity of the annual fiscal deficit target, which is of 3.3% of our GDP, whether we are going to meet this fiscal deficit target or not. So that is also in a question mark. So all these things indicate that there is a lesser chance of inflation in the near future. So there is lesser chance of RBI to increase the repo rate or reverse repo rate or the bank rate. Okay. So if you see in this picture, these are some of the economic hurdles which is experienced by our Indian economy. So our rupee is depreciating against the dollar, our oil prices is also getting increased, and the private capital is also under loss, and the banks are having a lot of NPAs, and import is increasing but the export are staggering or decreasing, and the FPI inflows are more. That means more and more FPI are now going out of the country. And the farmers are also facing a lot of distress in our country, and the power sector or power distribution companies are also getting stalled, and the project is not going as per expected, as well as a lot of unemployments. So these are all the economic hurdles of our present country situation. So now we are going to see this monetary policy committee. It has 6 members, 3 government members and 3 RBI members, including the RBI governor. So what they usually do is they fix the benchmark interest rates of the RBI, like the repo rate, reverse repo rate and the bank rate, and they set the inflation target also. Okay. So what the major thing you have to note in this article is the core inflation, which is different from the headline inflation, because it is having everything including food and fuel. Okay. But the core means it is excluding food and fuel. Why we are excluding the food and fuel means it is changing daily. That means it is a more volatile thing. So we are excluding it, so thereby we can achieve the more stable inflation, which is the core inflation. So here in this article, they are comparing the core inflation with the food inflation alone. So usually in Indian scenario, the food prices is more fluctuating. That is, the food inflation is more high. But in the recent days, the core inflation is catch up or running far ahead of the food inflation. So it is a major concern, right? So in order to tackle that, in order to maintain the core inflation very lesser rate than the food inflation or in general, the RBI is following the calibrated tightening. Calibrated tightening in the sense maintaining the repo rate, reverse repo rate or the bank rate, everything as it is. Okay. So they haven't changed the repo rate and all, right, in the recent months. This is actually aiming to stabilize or making to reduce the core inflation. Okay. So RBI is specially focused on inflation targeting, right? So any monetary policy and the target of the monetary policy's achievement is purely dependent on the inflation targeting of the RBI. But in the present scenario, there is a slower economic growth as well as the benign or very little inflation in the present situation. There is no reason for the RBI to increase the rates. So this is what they suggested in this article. Okay. So the last article is the Johnson & Johnson case is a step in the right direction finally. So what the news here is, the government announced that the patients who are affected by the faulty hip implants, or which is supplied by the Johnson & Johnson Private Limited, should be compensated between 30 lakh to 1.23 crores. Okay. And along with that, there should be an additional 10 lakh paid towards the non-pecuniary damages. So this is what the government recently announced. So it is the highest ever compensation announced for living human being in India. So now we are going to see what is the background. Due to the negligence of the Johnson & Johnson in approaching the patients, there is a lot of patients who are affected by the faulty hip implants. That means the implant which is provided or fitted in the patients, it is containing a metal, and this metal is started mixing with the blood of the patients and started giving a lot of injuries and pains to the patients. Okay. So this creating a lot of sufferings to the patient. So in order to compensate the patients who are affected by this faulty hip implant, the government is now trying to compensate or commensurate the pain as well as the loss of wages of the patients. So by means of doing this as a step, it acts as a precedence for future cases of these kind of medical negligence by any company, whether it is a private or a public, to be paid to the patients in case of injuries caused by these kind of faulty medical devices. So it is like setting a precedence to others, right? And the Ministry of Health is also approving for the formula for determining the quantum of compensation which should be paid for the patients. That is, if a person is very lesser in age and more the percentage of disability, then he should get the higher compensation. So this is how they actually determine the compensation for each and every patients. And if you note here one important thing, that is one thing called a locus standi principle, which means the patients or the aggrieved persons generally should approach the court for getting the compensation or for getting the justice. But in this case, they following one thing which is called parens patriae doctrine. So in this parens patriae doctrine, apart from the aggrieved person, anyone can approach the court and initiate the process. Okay, so in this case the government is acting as a parent for these faulty hip implants patients, and they directly give the compensation for them, right? So if you see, in 1985 during the Bhopal gas tragedy, the people who are getting affected by the Bhopal gas tragedy, they are getting the compensation by only through this parens patriae doctrine. So similar thing is now also followed. Okay, and apart from this step, one more good initiative here is they just want to amend the Drugs Cosmetics Act of 1940 to include the pharmaceutical companies also in the list, thereby they should be liable to pay compensation to the affected persons. Okay, so these pharmaceutical companies are coming under the ambit of CDSCO, which is the Central Drugs Standard Control Organization. So once the Drugs and Cosmetics Law 1940, if it gets amended and once it becomes a law, then it becomes mandatory, and it ensures that the company or the entity, whoever responsible for the affected persons, should make the payment to the respective persons. Okay, so this is a welcome step. So the right of victim for compensation is still now suffering in India, but after this JJ case and its effective implementation by the government, India has definitely set a new precedent to all other future happenings.